one of the foremost students of Sheikh Muhammad Nasruddin Al-Albani, rahimahullah, and he has come to give us some lectures regarding important issues of the deen. I believe that most of our brothers know him, and those who don't, inshallah ta'ala, hopefully these few days that he is with us, will get to know him, inshallah. The subject that he's going to speak about at this point is the life of Sheikh Nasir, Muhammad Nasruddin Al-Albani, rahimahullah.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد فإن العلم رفيع الدرجات وأهله هم أهل الله وخاصته وكلما ازداد الإنسان علما كلما ازداد لله خشية والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول خصلتان لا تجتمعان في منافق حسن سمت وفقه في دين فحسن السمت هو التخلق بأخلاق المؤمنين والتأدب بآداب الصالحين ظاهرا وباطنا والفقه في الدين هو العلم بكتاب رب العالمين والتفقه بسنة سيد المرسلين صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه أجمعين كمثل ما كان يقول الإمام الذهبي رحمه الله العلم قال الله قال رسوله قال الصحابة ليس بالتمويه ما العلم نصبك للخلاف سفاهة بين الرسول وبين رأي فقيه فطلب العلم صبر وجهاد مثابرة واستعداد تقوى لله ومعرفة لسنة رسول الله وعلم بكتاب الله وصيانة لشريعة الله أما زخرفة الكلمات وتزيين العبارات بما قد يكون مهيجا للنفوس ومثيرا للعواطف من غير علم ولا دليل ولا بينة فليس هذا من العلم في شيء ولئن انطلى بعض أمره على بعض من الناس حينا من الدهر فلا بد أن ينكشف وأن ينجلي وأن تظل راية العلم خفاقة عالية لا تدانيها راية ولا يقترب منها لواء
Sheikh Hafizahullah, after mentioning the Khutbah Tahajjah, said that knowledge is very high levels. and the people of knowledge are the particular of Allah Tabarak Ta'ala, are the people of Allah Tabarak Ta'ala and His particular creatures. The more a person increases in knowledge, the more he fears Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, two characteristics that a hypocrite cannot have. One is husn as-samt, which is to have good character, to have the character of the believers, to have the character of the righteous, outwardly and inwardly. And fiqh fid-deen, knowledge of deen. This means knowledge of the book of Allah Ta'ala, and knowledge of the sunnah of Mustafa Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. For it is, as Imam Dhahabi Rahimullah says, the knowledge is what Allah has said, and what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said, and what the Sahaba have said. There is no ambiguity to this. Knowledge is not making a level between a faqih and between the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or raising a difference between the faqih and the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Knowledge is patience. Knowledge is jihad. Knowledge is taqwa. Fear of Allah Tabarak Ta'ala. Knowledge is knowledge. Knowledge is knowing the sunnah of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Knowledge is knowing the book of Allah Tabarak Ta'ala. That is knowledge. Regarding beautiful statements and phrases made by people that may move their hearts and may move emotions and may move some people, but in reality it is not knowledge. For it will go away, and true knowledge will be known by the book, the Quran, and by the sunnah. And true knowledge be raised into such a degree that it is the only banner that is held high.
ومحاضرتنا اليوم أيها الإخوة في الله محاضرة يجتمع فيها ذكر العلم والعمل ويلتقي في قاعدتها الفقه والخلق. محاضرتنا حول عالم من أهل العلم، فرد بين الناس، لو جامل الناس وسايسهم وداراهم لكان كلمة إجماع لا تنقض، لكن الحق أحب إليه من كل شيء، فصرح وصدع ونافح وكافح وثبت على ما يعتقد أنه الحق، ولم يكن هذا الثبات منه مكابرة، لا والله، وإنما كان علامة على الحق وهداية إلى سواء السبيل واتباعا للحق في كثيره وقليله، وإننا لا نتذكر عند ذكرنا لهذا الشيخ وعند مرورنا بمراحل حياته، نتذكر وقد مات وانتقل إلى الرفيق الأعلى وهو الآن عند ربه، ولا نزكيه على الله، نتذكر قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن الله لا يقبض العلم انتزاعا ولكن يقبضه بموت العلماء، حتى إذا لم يبق عالم اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهالا فاستفتوهم فأفتوا بغير علم فضلوا وأضلوا. إنه شيخنا العلامة الإمام أسد السنة الهمام أبو عبد الرحمن محمد ناصر الدين الألباني رحمه الله تعالى، ونتذكر عند ذكره إخوانه أهل العلم الذين عرفوا قدره وعلموا منزلته فأدوها له ووفروه حقها، كمثل أخيه سماحة العلامة الوالد الشيخ أبي عبد الله عبد العزيز بن عبد الله بن باز رحمه الله، الذي سئل عن الشيخ في حياتهما بطبيعة الحال ما قولك في الشيخ الألباني، فقال: لا أعلم تحت أديم السماء أعلم بسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من الشيخ الألباني. نعم، لا يعرف الفضل لأهل الفضل إلا ذو الفضل، لأنهم يعرفون المقاييس والمعايير التي تقاس بها الحقائق وتعرف من خلالها الأصول. أما من لم يميز ذلك ولم يفهم ولم يعرف، فتراه يخبط خبط عشواء في الصباح والمساء. فنسأل الله لنا ولكم ولهم العافية.
When we begin to talk about this great Sheikh Rahimahullah, we talk about an individual who is unique. We talk about an individual connected himself to the truth. We talk about an individual, and we talk about a matter in our lecture here that brings together knowledge and action, that brings together fiqh, understanding, and khuluq. This individual was unique. He was such an individual to follow the truth that even if all of mankind had to gather on one side, which was not the truth, and he was upon the truth, he would not pay any attention to them, he would stay upon the truth. And he did not do this out of arrogance, but rather he did this because the truth was the most important matter to him. And in following truth in every little and small matter, he was an individual that benefited the ummah, an individual that had patience, an individual that stuck to the truth. When we talk about this individual, and he has passed away, and he has went to his Lord, and we do not purify anyone above what Allah Ta'ala says, but we think about what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we reflect upon the narration of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that is, Allah Ta'ala does not take knowledge by snatching it out of the hearts of individuals, but he takes the knowledge by the passing away of the scholars. And to such degree that once the scholars have passed away, the people take the ignorant as leaders, and they ask them in their matters of deen, and they give them a ruling, and they are astray, so they lead others astray. So when we talk about this great scholar, we think about this. And of course we're speaking about Abdul Rahman Muhammad Nasruddin Al-Albani Rahimahullah. When we speak about the Sheikh, the first and foremost thing that comes to our mind is what his brothers in knowledge have said about him. Other scholars, his brothers in knowledge have said about him, what they have said about him. And first and foremost is Abu Abdullah Abdulaziz ibn Baz Rahimahullah, who when he was asked about Sheikh Nasir Rahimahullah, of course while both of them was alive, what is your statement regarding Sheikh Nasir? He says, I don't know anyone under the heavens more knowledgeable about the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than Muhammad Nasruddin al-Albani rahimahullah. No one knows the virtues except people who possess the same virtue. Those who can judge in truth based upon knowledge. But as the one who doesn't have knowledge, then of course he is not the judge, and he will make mistake after mistake.
ولو أننا نظرنا أيها الإخوة في الله وتأملنا في قصة شيخنا لرأيناها عجيبة وعجيبة جدا، ولأخذنا منها عبرا كثيرة وكثيرة جدا. ونحن ابتداء نقول كلامنا عن شيخنا أو عن غيره من مشايخنا ليس من باب تعظيم الرجال لذواتهم، وإنما هو من باب تعظيمهم لما معهم من الحق، إنما هو رفع بما رفعهم الله به. يرفع الله الذين أوتوا العلم درجات، أيها الإخوة في الله، إن شيخنا رحمه الله تعالى ولد في وسط أوروبا، ويشاء الله له أن ينتقل إلى بلاد المسلمين ليكون منارة عين وليكون راية حق وليكون باب خير. ففي أوائل هذا القرن الإفرنجي ولد الشيخ الألباني في ألبانيا في السنة 14 من أول القرن، وكانت ألبانيا حينذاك تحكم من حاكم يقال له أو يدعى أحمد زوغو. ولقد سمعت شيخنا رحمه الله إذا ذكر أحمد زوغو هذا قال داعيا عليه أزاغ الله قلبه. فكان يشدد على المسلمين وكان ينكل بهم ويشردهم ويشدد عليهم، فما كان من والد ناصر الدين الألباني الفتى في ذلك الحين إلا أن أراد أن يهاجر بدينه وأن يفر بأولاده حماية لهم ورعاية لتربيتهم. وكان الحاج نوح نجاتي وهو اسم والد شيخنا من كبار علماء المذهب الحنفي في بلاده، وكان درس في تركيا أيام الدولة العثمانية الفقه الحنفي حتى صار كالمفتي في بلاده، وكان يقرأ من ضمن ما يقرأ فضائل الشام وفضائل أهلها وفضائل السكنى فيها، فقر قراره أن تكون هجرته إلى بلاد الشام.
If we look, my beloved brothers in Allah, to the stories regarding the life of Sheikh Nasser rahimahullah, we will be astonished and we will learn many lessons about him. And when we talk about him, or we talk about other mashayikh, it is not meant that we want to glorify them as themselves or glorify them personally based on their themselves, but rather what we intend by it is to glorify what they're upon, of the correctness of what they're upon, what Allah Ta'ala had granted them of the truth. Because Allah says in Quran that He raises those of knowledge upon levels. He raises those of knowledge upon levels. It should be known that our Shaykh Rahimullah was born in the middle of Europe. Was born in the middle of Europe. But Allah Ta'ala willed for him to migrate to the land of the Muslims until he became a light post for the truth and a sign for the truth and a caller to the truth. The Shaykh Rahimullah was born according to the European century, what would be, I guess, last century for us, since they say this is 2000 now, in the 1914, the beginnings of that 1914, 1914 years, the Sheikh was born, rahimahullah, And the town was Albania. The town he was born in, or the country he was born in, was Albania. At that time, it was ruled by a ruler by the name of Ahmad Zogha. And he said that the Shaykh, rahimahullah, when he would mention this particular ruler, would say, may Allah tabarak ta'ala misguide his heart. And this is because this Ahmad Zogha was oppressive to the Muslims. He was oppressive and abusive ruler to the Muslims. And since this was the case, it came to the father of Sheikh Muhammad Nasruddin al-Albani, Al-Hajj Nur Najati, the father of Sheikh Nasser, to migrate. And the father of Sheikh Nasser, rahimahullah, was a great Hanafi scholar, having studied in Turkey, and this was during the Uthman Empire of that time, and he studied the books of the Ahnaf, and among the books that he studied also were the books speaking about the virtues of Sham. Sham being Syria, Jordan, Palestine, that area. Sham. And the virtues of Sham and the virtues of his people. And based upon that, he decided to take his family to Sham, to migrate to Sham.
وهذا كله يذكرنا بقول الله تبارك وتعالى ورفعنا لك ذكرك. فإن للإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله كلمة بديعة في ذكر أهل الحديث وعلو قدرهم ورفعة الله لهم، قال فيها لكل ناصر للسنة ملتزم بها داع إليها نصيب من قوله تعالى ورفعنا لك ذكرك، ولكل مبغض للسنة مناقض لها راد على أهلها نصيب من قوله تعالى إن شانئك هو الأبتر. هذه هي الرفعة كما ذكرنا، يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات، درجات في الدنيا ودرجات عند الله، ولهذا تهيئة وله أسباب، كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى ما كان لهم الخيرة، ما كان لهم الخيرة. لماذا هاجر إلى الشام؟ لماذا لم يبق كغيره من الغلمان؟ لماذا حبب الله إليه علم الحديث؟ لماذا هاجر من بلاد إلى بلاد؟ كل ذلك من توفيق رب العباد، كل ذلك من تيسير الله عز وجل له لينشر السنة في زمان قل فيه أهلها وندر فيه الداعون لها وخفت فيه صوتها، فجاء كما قلنا من وسط بلاد الكفر إلى لب بلاد الإسلام. لا يعرف لماذا جاء وكيف جاء وما مصيره وما هي طريقته، إنما ذلك كله من توفيق الله عز وجل، ومن تمام التوفيق أن هذا الغلام الألباني دخل كعادة الغلمان في مدرسة نظامية، وقبل أن يتم مرحلته الدراسية الابتدائية الأولى أمره أبوه أن يخرج من المدرسة، يقول هذه المدارس لا تعطي علما فاخرج من المدرسة وتعلم العلم الشرعي عند أهله. فبدأ أبوه يعلمه الفقه والقرآن والتجويد، وبدأ بعض شيوخه كذلك كالشيخ سعيد البرهاني يعلمه بعض علوم اللغة والبلاغة والنحو، وهكذا توفيق من الله وأمور تسير كما يريد الله. وهذا الشاب لا علم له بشيء، إنما يسير كما يسير عامة الصبية والفتيان في ذلك الزمان، إلا أن توفيق الله له عز وجل بأنه لم يتمم دراسته، وإنما توجه لدراسة العلم كما ذكرنا عند أهل العلم في المساجد وفي دور العلم، حتى صارت عنده من العلم منزلة تفوق أهله وأقرانه، حتى كان معلم اللغة العربية الذي يعلمه ويدرسه إذا استعصت مسألة من مسائل النحو والإعراب على بقية الطلاب قال: نادوا لنا ناصرا الأعجمي ليعلمكم أيها العرب.
This reminds us, this, when we talk about this matter, it reminds us of the statement of Allah تبارك وتعالى: ورفعنا لك ذكرك. And we will raise you in being mentioned. And this is something that Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah talks about regarding Ahlul Hadith, regarding those who support the Sunnah, regarding those who are upon the truth, that they have a part of this ayah that Allah will raise their mentioning. Every person of the Sunnah, every supporter of the Sunnah has a part of this verse that we will raise your mentioning. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَ. Similarly, every individual who turns away from the Sunnah and is an enemy of the Sunnah and is cut off from the Sunnah has a part of the ayah إِنَّ شَعْنِيَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرِ. Verily your enemy is cut off. Allah Ta'ala says they have no choice, or it was not for them to choose. It was not for Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah to choose where he was going when they migrated from Albania going to Sham. It was just the tawfiq of Allah Ta'ala. Why did not his father just stay there where he was or go somewhere else? Why was it that he came to the land of the Muslims? Why was it that he brought along this young man who become one who would revive the Sunnah? He would come at a time where the Sunnah had very few followers, and the knowledge of Hadith was as if almost non-existent. Where the Sunnah had no voice, was this not except tawfiq, except the grace of Allah tabaraka ta'ala upon him? That he had no choice, no choice on the move that his father migrate, the move of his father migrating from one land to another. No choice in any way. Matters went according to the plans of Allah tabaraka ta'ala. And from also a completion of the tawfiq or the grace of Allah tabaraka ta'ala is that he went to in the beginning to elementary school, but his father pulled him out of it, saying that this system or this way of learning does not benefit you. So he started to turn him towards Islamic knowledge and teach him Islamic knowledge, knowledge of Quran, knowledge of tajweed, knowledge of fiqh and so on and so forth. And he would also learn from various mashayikh like Saeed Burhani, who was teaching him Nahw or the Arabic language. This is a way that Allah Ta'ala wanted it to happen. This shab, this young man was just like any other young man, any other person being raised, any other person living. But this was the tawfiq of Allah Ta'ala that he would get that this person, this Shaykh rahimahullah, will get an understanding at a very early age for the importance of knowledge, the importance of knowledge, and that he would acquire knowledge in the masajid. And he became so knowledgeable regarding Arabic language that many times he came above and beyond his peers, not only in the Islamic knowledge, but in the knowledge of the Arabic language, to such a degree that when there was an issue that was difficult, the teacher would say, let me call Nasir. Call Nasir, the Ajami, the non-Arab, so that he can teach you Arabic.
(Clears وحبه للعلم والقراءة، والذي عنده نهمة ورغبة في أن يقرأ كل ما يقع تحت يديه من الكتب، فكان يقرأ القصص وكان يقرأ المجلات رحمة الله عليه. وكانت هذه المجلة على ما عليها من ملاحظات كانت تنصر السنة، وكانت ترد البدعة، وكان صاحبها حريصا على الأحاديث الصحيحة رادا للأحاديث الضعيفة، وهكذا فضلا عن العقيدة والتوحيد. وأكرر على ما عليه من ملاحظات، فوقع عدد من هذه المجلة تحت يد هذا الفتى وهو لم يبلغ 20 من العمر، لا يزال في 17، في 17 أو في 18. وكان هذا العدد من مجلة المنار يحتوي مقالا للشيخ محمد رشيد رضا في نقد أحاديث إحياء علوم الدين للغزالي، وبيان ما فيه من أحاديث ضعيفة وموضوعة ومكذوبة ولا أصل لها، وكان ينقد ذلك نقدا علميا. في سنده فلان وهو ضعيف، قال عالم الفلاني كذا وهو موضوع، ضعفه فلان وحكم عليه فلان، فكانت هذه الأمور تطرق سمع ذلك الفتى الألباني الصغير أول مرة في حياته، فوجد شيئا يشده إلى ذلك ويحببه إليه ويقربه منه. وكان من ضمن ما في هذا المقال الإشارة إلى أن للحافظ ابن حجر أن للحافظ العراقي كتابا في تخريج أحاديث إحياء علوم الدين اسمه المغني عن حمل الأسفار في الأسفار،
الأسفار مجلدات يعني،
المغني عن حمل الأسفار في الأسفار في تخريج ما في الإحياء من أخبار. وكان هذا الفتى فقيرا لا يكاد يجد ما يشتري به كتبه الدراسية، فكيف هذا الكتاب الكبير؟ فبحث فوجد الكتاب لكن لا يستطيع أن يشتريه، فماذا يفعل؟ استأجره استئجارا، استأجره من صاحب مكتبة اسمه أحمد عبيد، توفي قبل سنوات قليلة عن أكثر من 100 سنة، ونسخ هذا الألباني الصغير ذلك الحين كتاب المغني عن حمل الأسفار في الأسفار بخط يده في 3 مجلدات. ولم يكتفي فقط بالنسخ، بل كان يراجع الكتب فيما أشكل عليه أو فيما لم يفهم. ولقد رأيت الكتاب بعيني مؤرخا قبل أكثر من 60 عاما، والشيخ بعد في 19 أو حولها، إما أكثر قليلا أو أقل قليلا. وفيه من الفوائد اللغوية والفقهية والحديثية والعلمية الشيء الكثير الكثير. وأعجب من ذلك كله خطه المتقن الحسن الجميل، الذي لو رأيته من بعد لظننت أنه مطبوع على آلة كاتبة، وذلك قبل أكثر من 60 عاما. فهذا يدل على صبره وتجلده ومرابطته وثباته ورغبته وحرصه. فكان هذا هو الشرارة الأولى التي نجم بها علمه وعرف بها فضله وبز فيها أقرانه.
He said, the Shaykh, rahimahullah, because of his great love for knowledge. He had a great thirst for knowledge. He began by reading all types of books. He would read stories. He would read magazines. He would read newspapers. Because he was not directed at that time to any particular sciences of the sciences of Islam. But rather it was just that he had a thirst for knowledge, and whatever would come before his hands he would read. He said it was the decree of Allah tabarak ta'ala that one day it fell into his hands a magazine called Minar, which was printed in Egypt. And the one who was over this particular magazine was Muhammad Rashid Rida. And he said, even though that this magazine has some mistakes, it had in it a call to the Sunnah. It contained in it responses against bid'ah and avoiding bid'ah. And one of the other matters that it also contained was that it would try to make sure, the individuals who were over this magazine would try to make sure that only authentic narrations or authentic ahadith were related within their magazine. And they will avoid the weak narrations or the forged narrations. And he said, I repeat again that this magazine had some mistakes, but it had also these benefits that he has mentioned. And this book or this majalla or this magazine fell into his hand while the Sheikh Rahimahullah was not yet 20 years of age. He was either 17 or 18. He read in this particular magazine an article written by Muhammad Rashid Rida, in which he discussed the book of Ghazali, Ihya al-Umuddin. But he discussed it and criticized it in a knowledgeable fashion. Knowledge-based criticism of what was contained in it. Saying that certain ahadith that he brought were weak. Certain ahadith or narrations that he brought were maudhu or forged. And going in more detail, saying that this particular chain of transmission, isnad, contains such and such narrator who such and such individual or such and such scholar says was weak, and therefore we cannot take this and so on and so forth. Very detailed takhrij or detailed examination of the narrations in that article. And this is the first time that young man, Al-Albani, rahimullah, heard this. And so it left an impression upon him. And he had heard about a book by Al-Hafidh Al-Iraqi, which a rough translation of the meaning of the book is that would make you self-sufficient over carrying large pages in your traveling. In it, Hafidh Al-Iraqi does a total takhrij of Ihya al-Umuddin. Sheikh Nasser, rahimahullah, found this book, but he was poor. He didn't have any money. He didn't have any money to buy anything. So what about a book? So what he did with this, he asked the owner of this place, Ahmad Ubaid, who he said, Sheikh said, died not too long ago, and he was over 100 years old, to ask him to rent this book. To rent it. So the Sheikh rented the book from this particular individual, and the Sheikh began to write. But it wasn't a matter of his just writing and copying it through written in a written manner. He would also go to the books for those matters that were unclear to him. If he misunderstood a particular aspect of language, he would go to a book and write regarding that. If he misunderstood something regarding fiqh or something regarding hadith and so on and so forth, he would do that. So he said this book contained many, many benefits. And the Sheikh said he's seen it. He has seen this book that the Sheikh did while he was 18 or 19. And he's seen the book 60 years later. And he said what he noticed from it was that it contained not only benefits in language, not only benefits in fiqh and other benefits, but that also what he noticed was the beautiful way and meticulous way it was written. That if you were to see from a distance what was written, you would think that it was printed. So this shows the Sheikh's, rahimahullah's, patience. It shows his zeal for knowledge. It shows his level of giving importance to knowledge to such a degree that he overcame even his peers, or he was beyond his peers in such an early age. And this was the first act of knowledge that the Sheikh was involved in, And this raised his position and his understanding, and it shows his zeal and it shows his patience.
وبسبب هذا العلم والتوجه إليه والعناية به عرف هذا الشاب بين عامة الناس أنه يشتغل في السنة ويشتغل في الحديث وأنه ينقح ويصحح ويجرح بل أنه يفتي وهو شاب فكانت تأتيه الأسئلة والفتاوى بما يليق في ذلك العصر على صغره وقلته حتى وقع أمر فيه عجب وهو يمثل أول عمل علمي مستقل قام به ذلك الشاب الألباني في ذلك الوقت وهو يتعلق بأبيه حيث كان أبوه رحمه الله كعامة الناس في ذلك الوقت ذا تأثر بالتصوف والطرق الصوفية فكان يذهب لبعض القبور التي فيها بعض الصالحين زعموا ويطلب البركة بالصلاة في تلك المساجد فما كان من ناصر الدين الألباني ذلك الشاب إلا أن كتب رسالة بعنوان تحذير الساجد من اتخاذ القبور مساجد وهي مطبوعة اليوم منذ أكثر من 30 سنة والشيخ ألفها قبل أكثر من 50 سنة ردا على أبيه فقدم الرسالة لأبيه وناصحه بها فلما رأى أبوه منه هذا الشيء عارضه ابتداء إما أن تسير على المذهب الحنفي مقلدا وإما أن تترك البيت فحاول ذلك الشاب أن يطيع أباه وأن يصلح أمره معه وأن يعلمه أو أن ينبهه أن العلم المقرون بالدليل هو الأصل وأن التقليد ليس هو من الشرع في شيء فأبى فما كان منه إلا أن خرج من البيت ولكن كان هذا الخروج مؤقتا فبعد قليل من الزمن أيقن ذلك الوالد أن هذا الولد يسير بخطى ثابتة وبأقدام راسخة وأن عنده من العلم المحقق والقول الموثق والنقل المصدق ما جعله خيرا من كثير من الناس لا أقول من أقرانه وأسنانه بل من العلماء والأعيان في ذلك الزمان الذين لم يكونوا يربطون الناس بالكتاب والسنة بل لم يكونوا يعرفون أو يسمعون ربط المسائل بالدلائل وإنما كان غايتهم أو كانت غايتهم التقليد والعصبية والمذهبية بصورة شديدة وشديدة جدا لما عرف الوالد هذا التميز وهذه الرفعة التي ذكرناها ونذكرها وسنكررها عرف أن هذا هو الحق فما كان منه بعد حين إلا أن أمر ولده أن يرجع إلى بيته بل كان يسأل ولده أسئلة حديثية وأنا وقفت على حديث في السلسلة الضعيفة المجلد الأول يقول فيه الشيخ وهذا حديث سألني عنه بعض القريبين مني ثم رأيت بخطه على نسخته الخاصة قوله وهو والدي رحمه الله.
Once it became apparent and well known amongst the people that this, because of his sticking to knowledge and seeking knowledge and sticking to the sunnah, it became known amongst the people that he was an individual involved in the sunnah, involved in knowledge of the sunnah, involved in research of the sunnah. And he became popular regarding this issue. And to the people would come asking questions regarding the sunnah. Not only that, but until they begin to ask from him fatawa. Even though he was as young as he was, they would begin to ask from him questions regarding their problems. Questioning him regarding their problems, and he would give them a fatwa regarding that issue, according to the level of knowledge that the people had around him at that time. And a good example of this, he says, this young man seeking knowledge, and this young man known now by everyone within his area of seeking the sunnah and sticking to the sunnah, it was an issue that took place that will astonish us. And that is the issue which shows the first independent knowledge, independent research that the Sheikh did by himself and actually wrote it into a book form. And that is, at that time, as we know, the tasawwuf, those who are the Sufis, were rampant. And everyone was involved in some form of this tasawwuf, even to such a degree, the father of Sheikh Nasser, in a sense that they would go to the graves of certain righteous people, to the graves of certain righteous people, or what they believe, he said, to be righteous people, and they will make salat there, as they say, for the barakah. So they go with these particular places that these individuals were buried in, and they would take them at places of worship, believing that there was barakah or blessing in it. So Sheikh Nasser, even though he is young, as we said he is, at this stage in his life, Rahimullah wrote his first work in this regard, and he called it Tahdhir al-Sajid, warning the one who prostrates, that it is haram or forbidden to take places that have graves in them as masajid. And he said, this is printed down, and it is a book that is available now. And it was printed 30 years ago, even though the Sheikh wrote it 50 years ago. The Sheikh, rahimahullah, gave this to his father. And his father looked at it. He gave it to him to advise his father. His father looked at it and rejected it, and said, either you are going to be upon the madhab that I am on, upon the Hanafi madhab. Either you are going to stick to it and blind follow it, or you are going to leave. You are going to have to leave this house. So this young Al-Albani, rahimahullah, trying to obey his father, tries to inform his father regarding this issue, that knowledge is based upon the book of Allah tabarak ta'ala, in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that it is that which is followed based upon evidences, that which is based upon Quran, upon sunnah. And having tried all he could, he eventually had to leave the house of his father. He eventually had to leave the house of his father. But this leaving of the house of his father was only for a period of time, until his father looked with amazement upon his son and saw that he is in fact upon the steps, or upon the path of truth, climbing the steps of knowledge, and that what he is upon is the haq, that what Al-Albani at that time, rahimahullah, was upon was not, we can say, just better than his peers, but better than many of the scholars at that time. For the scholars at that time, majority of them were followers of the schools of thoughts. And majority of them were blind followers, and they were called to blind following. And they were not connecting the people to the scholars of Quran and Sunnah. So Al-Albani came to say that there is no taqlid in this regard. There is no taqlid in this regard, as they have taken it as the only path to truth. And that in fact the path to truth is to return to the book of Allah tabarak ta'ala, and into the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When his father realized this matter, he asked or requested that his son come back to his home. And he started to accept various, or ask Sheikh Nasser various questions. to the degree that he used to ask him even about certain ahadith. And the Sheikh said, I saw with my own eyes in the first volume of Silsila Ahadith al-Da'ifa, the series of weak hadith, the Sheikh mentions a narration and says, some of my close relatives have asked me or questioned me about this hadith. And then at the bottom, he has written that close relative was my beloved father, rahimahullah.
ومن تمام التوفيق الرباني لذلك الفتى الألباني حين ذاك أن في مدينة دمشق التي سكنها واستقر بها وطلب العلم فيها مكتبة لا كالمكتبات، مكتبة أسست منذ قرون وجمعت فيها الكتب والمؤلفات والمصنفات، المخطوط فيها قد يكون أكثر من المطبوع، وقد يكون المطبوع فيها لا يعزب عنه شيء ولا يفوته شيء. فلم يكتفي ذلك الشاب بالكتب التي قد يستأجرها أو يشتريها أو يستعيرها، فيمم وجهه شطر المكتبة الظاهرية ليقرأ من كتبها وينهل من علومها. فكان يأتي على باب المكتبة قبل أن يأتي الموظفون، وكان لا يخرج منها إلا بعد أن ينتهي الوقت حتى يقول له لقد انتهى الوقت، وهو مثابر وصابر ومرابط يطلب العلم ويدون ويقيد ويراجع. حتى لاحظ ذلك ملاحظة واضحة أصحاب المكتبة والقائمون عليها، فرأوا أن يخصصوا له فيها غرفة وأن يعطوه لها مفتاحا، وهذا نادر لأنه ليس موظفا، وهذه أموال عامة وكتب يخشى عليها، لكنهم وثقوا به ثقة عظيمة واطمأنوا له اطمئنانا كبيرا لما رأوا من حسن سمته وكبير صبره وتمام خلقه وكمال أدبه وحسن صنيعه. فكان يأتي بعد الفجر ولا ينصرف إلا بعد العشاء، لا يرفع رأسه من الكتاب إلا للقمة يأكلها أو صلاة يؤديها. وقال بعض من عايشوه هنالك، قال كنا إذا جئنا نسأله يجيبنا بعين واحدة، كأن عينا على السائل وعينا على الكتاب، لا يريد أن يرفع رأسه. وهكذا جمع له وهيأ الله له ما لم يهيأ لغيره، قد يكون من كثير من السبق ممن سبق، ويقينا في أكثر من جاء ممن لحق. وهذا يذكرني بكلمة نقلها إلي بعض الإخوة من طلاب العلم، يذكرون فيها أن بعض الكتاب باللغة الإنجليزية ذكر في كتاب من كتبه أنه لا يوثق بما نقله الشيخ الألباني عن هذه المخطوطات، قال لأننا لم نرها وما يدرينا أنه نقلها نقلا دقيقا. فقلت في نفسي يا لهذا المسكين ما أجهله، إن ثمرة هذا الإشكال تعني الطعن في الإسلام وعلماء الإسلام، وإلا فهل اطلع هذا المسكين على مصادر الحافظ ابن حجر في فتح الباري؟ هل هل اطلع هذا المسكين بل المسيكين
كيف ستترجمها؟
هل اطلع هذا المسيكين على مصادر الإمام النووي في شرح صحيح مسلم؟ هل اطلع على مصادر العلامة السيوطي في كتاب الدر المنثور التي قد تكون وصلت إلى مئات الكتب؟ هل اطلع على مصادر كتاب السيرة الشامية التي بلغت 1000 كتاب؟ ولئن عرف هذه هل هو قادر على أن يتابع كل مصدر ويتوثق منه؟ هذا هو الجهل. لذلك نصيحتي لهذا الأخ أن يتوب إلى الله من هذه الباقعة، وأن يرجع عما سطره بيمينه، فإنه يحمل التشكيك بعلماء الإسلام، والتشكيك بعلماء الإسلام فيه التشكيك بالإسلام نفسه. ما وفق الله إليه ذلك الفتى الألباني من مراجع ومصادر موثقة ومحققة ومدققة كان سببا كبيرا فيما هيأه الله له ليتبوأ الصدارة في علم الحديث في هذا القرن كله من أوله إلى آخره. نعم هناك علماء فضلاء آخرون في مصر والشام والمغرب والهند والباكستان، لكنهم جميعا كانوا يقرون له. وأذكر شيئا، قبل 25 سنة ورد للجنة الدائمة للإفتاء في بلاد الحرمين استفتاء حول حديث غريب، يسألونهم ما هو درجة صحة هذا الحديث، حديث غريب في ألفاظه وكلماته، فما كان منهم إلا أن أرسلوا رسالة إلى الهند يستفتون فيها الشيخ العلامة عبيد الله الرحمن المبارك فوري صاحب كتاب مرعاة المفاتيح، يسألونه ما هو أو ما هي درجة صحة هذا الحديث. فما كان من الشيخ المبارك فوري إلا أن رد إليهم الخطاب وقال ليس يصلح لهذا إلا الشيخ العلامة الألباني في بلاد المسلمين وفي بلاد العرب. هذه مرة أخرى نقول لا يعرف الفضل لأهل الفضل إلا ذو الفضل.
Another matter that shows the completion of the tawfiq of Allah Ta'ala upon this young man was that in the city of Damascus there was a great old library that had been established centuries before, that had many books that were printed and books that were manuscripts. Those that were in manuscript form probably outnumbered the books that had been published or printed. And those that had been published and printed, you can say that they did not leave out anything. That they covered, almost missed nothing. That they covered the whole rim of Islamic knowledge and history and so on and so forth. The Sheikh, besides in the matter of renting books and so on and so forth, and the books that he would find in the marketplaces or the general areas of the town, he would not just stop there, but he would go to this great maktaba called Maktaba Zahiriyya. And he would arrive at this maktaba early, before it would open up. As a matter of fact, he would arrive there before the very various workers that worked there would arrive there. And he would go in, and he would remain there until such time as they would come to him and say, it's time to go. Time has ended. It's time to close. And they noticed this from him, this young man, Al-Albani, rahimahullah, that he was like this, that he would look in the books and that he would be there all day long, that he would beat them to the door and be the last one coming out until they would have to tell him that it was time to close. So when they noticed his patience and his good character and his truthfulness, they gave him a key and allowed him to enter upon his own a room to study those books in. And the Sheikh would do this. At his disposal would be these makhtutat and these great books that he could refer to. And he would study. He would go there for Fajr and would not leave until after Isha. The only thing would stop him from being between the books and doing research and checking and revising and reviewing would be something that he would have to eat or the five times daily salat that he would have to make. To such a degree, he said that some of the people who knew the Sheikh at this time would say that we would enter upon Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah and he would have a book. And we would ask him a question and it would be as if he was answering us with one eye. He would not like to leave the book, so one eye would be as if one eye was in the book.